will now call to order the January 10th, 2017 meeting of the City of Aiken Planning Commission. For those of you who may not have joined us for previous meetings, let me share a little bit about our process and our guidelines. We have several applications to review today. When that application is called, I will first ask if someone would like to speak on behalf of that application, and they may come forward and address the commission. If you do have comments to make, if you would pause before leaving in case any of the commissioners have questions for you, then I will ask if anyone would like to speak in opposition to the application, and then I'll just ask if anyone would like to make any other comments in rebuttal. We ask that everyone please either mute or turn off your cell phones out of respect for those who are going to speak. And I will double check mine because I would be very embarrassed if mine was the one that went off. All right. Okay. Now, our first item of business then for today is approval of the minutes of the December 13th, 2016 work session and regular meeting. Are there any corrections or changes or additions to the minutes that you have received? Not hearing any, may I accept a motion for approval?
Madam Chair, I moved that we approve the minutes submitted for December 13th for both the work session and the regular meeting.
Okay, may I have a second?
Second.
All in favor of accepting them? Thank you, they're unanimously approved. All right, our first order of business, since it is our January meeting, is the election of officers. There are three positions: the chair, the vice chair, and the secretary, which is traditionally our planning director. So I'd like to open the floor for nominations for commission chair.
Madam Chair, I would like to renominate you, Liz Stewart, for another year as chair.
Second.
Any other nominations? Yeah, well, not hearing any, then I'll call for the vote on that. All in favor? Yes, I better say yes. Okay. For vice chair, may I have some nominations for that role?
Madam Chair, I submit that Jack Hunter remain in the vice chair position.
Okay. May I have a second?
Second.
Okay, any others? All right, all in favor? Okay, and for secretary, generally a nomination from the chair is the planning director, Ryan Bland, and I so nominate him. I have a second. All right, all in favor? Ryan, it is you. All right. So now let's get to the business of the applications that we have before us. The first application is number 17-00003 for rezoning and 17-22003, the concept plan. The applicant, MKP Properties, Mark and Karen Potee. Is there someone who would like to speak to that application? This would be the part where you come down. And when you step forward to the podium, if you wouldn't mind sharing your name and address for the record.
I'm Karen Petit. My address is 113 Hartwell Drive, Aiken.
Okay. All right. Karen, is there anything that you want us to know or any questions you may have about the material that you have received, including the conditions that have been recommended?
What I'd like for you to know is that our intent is to take a property that has served the community well and repurpose it to a use that will benefit the community, benefit some people who otherwise wouldn't have another option. We're trying to beautify the property, maintain its sense of neighborhood and make sure that the property is safe so that our neighborhood stays intact and serves a good purpose for the community. I do have a question about concerning the event activities to be held in the former church sanctuary. Our intent with the church sanctuary is to keep it intact and to use it for community use. So we would just like a little bit more description of what event activities would be, because we've been asked by people in the community, would you allow us to do so and so, or would you allow the 4-H club to use the sanctuary and things like that. So we just want some more guidance on what number one under the concept plan, approval of the concept plan, could be conditioned on the following would be. And then also to ask, one thing we would like to use the sanctuary for, because it is a sanctuary with a stage, and we felt it would be a good use to have concerts, choir concerts and things like that, that may not be limited to Saturday or Sunday, but would certainly be limited to the hours that are stated. Just like clarification on that, please.
Okay. All right. Brian, would you like to discuss staff's position in making this recommendation?
Yeah, so staff's intent for the proposed condition of approval, and that's just what it is at this point, is a proposed condition of approval for you to consider as a commission. We tried to, as a staff, find a way for the uses on that site to be no less intense or no more intense than the peak uses at the church when it currently existed. So you're correct. I would say that I think currently states that the event activities held in the former church sanctuary should be held during weekends and only between hours of 8 and 9. So staff would consider event activities to be congregational activities. But again, the intent was just to limit, to place a limitation on that some way, again, that it would not impact the neighborhood any more than the church did in its existence. So there may be various ways to do that. Maybe it's a number of days per week. We floated out a time frame for that, but at the commission's pleasure, there may be a couple of different approaches you could take.
Okay. We just want to make sure that when people are already excited about the prospect of having a kind of a community center at their discretion to use, that we don't make promises to someone that they could use it for an event that we're not going to be allowed to do. We just want to make sure that we're clear, and that, because we don't want to upset anyone. We're trying to do a good thing for the community. We don't want to have to backtrack. So just want to make sure that we're clear on that.
I think one of the things would be maintaining the balance, because this would be a secondary use and not your primary business. So I think we want to have maybe some kind of a balance so that it didn't equal or exceed what you're doing in your regular business. I mean, if you were going to do this 40 hours a week and that 40 hours a week, then we'd have a dual use versus a secondary use. So I think that was probably another consideration in putting some kind of limit on it. Based on the interest that you've already received, what do you feel would be a more reasonable compromise from your perspective?
My concern was just the limit to the weekends. I really don't have an idea, because the sanctuary is bonus for us. That's not really part of our business. We just want the sanctuary, since we're going to own it, we want it to be put to good use. We don't want it to sit idle, because when buildings are idle, they attract vandals, they attract vagrants. People tend to know if no one's in the building, then we don't want to attract any kind of negative activity there. So that's just, I mean, we're just trying to do a good thing for, with the sanctuary and use it for a good purpose that's beneficial to the community. We don't want to have parties. We don't want to have, like, receptions and, right. and things like that.
Right.
Just things that a normal community center might have.
Now, are these events that you mentioned, things like the 4-H and all, are those all events that you're going to allow them to use the facility for free, or will this be a revenue-generating activity for you as well?
Our intent for, you know, small things would be just to let the community use them. As long as our insurance allows, and that's one thing that, you know, is going to govern a lot of what we can do, because we want to make sure that we're compliant with our insurance policy. But, you know, if someone, I don't know, if the Alzheimer's Association approached me and wanted to have one of their conferences in our space, that would be something that would attract a larger amount of people, but they're not going to do it on a week. They're not going to do it on a Saturday or a Sunday. More than likely, they're going to do it Monday through Friday. So those are the kind of things that go through my mind as far as limiting something that would be more than a handful of kids coming in for a 4-H meeting, mm-hmm. you know, that I'm trying to think. It's hard for me to think forward. But those are the kinds of things that people have asked us about.
Well, and you're smart to be doing that ahead of time, so we certainly appreciate that. Commissioners, any thoughts on Ms. Petit's concern?
You just talked about not having a crystal ball. None of us do for sure, but if you did, could you even hazard to guess how many nights a week you might want to use it during Monday through Friday? Do you have any idea?
I personally don't want to be doing anything many nights of the week except be at home with my family. But so, I mean, I really can't see it, anybody wanting to use it many more than two or three nights a week. Mm. It's not the number of nights. It's the limiting of which nights that was my question. I mean, I don't really have a problem with the limiting of a number of nights. I mean, it is in the middle of a neighborhood. And it is going to be in the evening, is mainly what the concern is. So that's not really the concern. My concern was, you know, if the Alzheimer's Association calls me back and I tell them, no, you have to do it on a Saturday or a Sunday, when it's not convenient for them to do that. I would just like a little bit of flexibility on those days.
Okay. Would it add some flexibility if we add, like, a Wednesday to the weekend?
Or maybe just, it might even just be easier to say no more than three nights a week or 3 days a week or however you want to word it. You know, no more than would probably be easier, because the purpose is to be helpful. And when we put people in a box, you can only do it on this, and this day, you're not being helpful anymore.
Well, I understand your desire to be helpful, but you're also in the middle of a neighborhood,
right.
as you yourself
That's
said.
Right, so we can limit.
And so when you're in that, you don't want to have something several nights a week that's going to bring in 30, 40, 50 cars in and out of there. That's the concern, I think, that would be reflected by the neighborhood if the question were put to them.
Right.
So I understand where you're coming from, but you understand where I have some concern. Obviously, the church, Wednesday night, the church would normally meet on Wednesday night.
Right.
I think Town Creek did have a lot of events there on Wednesday night. And, of course, that church, one thing you may know or may not know, that church predated the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Town Creek Church was there before the neighborhood was there. Now you're coming in, so everybody was comfortable with Town Creek Church. Nobody had a problem. But now you're new. You're a new guy with a whole new concept, a whole new design, whole new mission, which I don't think is a bad idea. I think it's a good idea. But I think there could very well be some pushback if you start having a whole lot of big events there on several nights a week.
Well, the condition is already Saturday and Sunday. That's already two nights. So I'm not asking for more than two nights. I'm just asking for flexibility in which two nights. So limit to two nights doesn't bother me, but some flexibility in which two nights so that we can be more flexible with the people who might want to use it. And there may not be many people that want to use it at all, which is fine. We just want it available for the community if because we have no other purpose for it. We don't want it to sit vacant. It's a beautiful structure, you know.
Well, it may depend to a certain extent on whether or not you charge them and how much you charge them.
Right.
If it's free, I will assure you, you will have a fair amount of interest.
I'm sure, and then that's where that limiting those nights would come in handy.
Now, you're keep saying nights, but you know this really is talking about the days from 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. So we're really saying day and night. You know, it's a longer period. It's, you know, 13 hours. So even though you're saying nights, are you saying you're not concerned about limiting it to two of those blocks of time as long as you have the flexibility to pick which two? Or are you just thinking that you wanted every day during the week and we're just talking nights? I just want to be clear what you're thinking.
Well, there aren't going to be, I can't foresee many daytime large number of groups needing that space. Like a sanctuary type space. I'm thinking the people that have talked to us so far, the Alzheimer's Association, a lady who does choirs, band concert, homeschool band concert, those things are generally in the evening. So that's kind of where my brain was going.
Okay.
I'm going to be busy during the day running our business. So I really can't devote a lot of time to trying to schedule, you know, things going on in the day.
Okay.
Over there. I just don't foresee there being a great big need. The only thing I can think of that people might want to use that space for during the day would be like support groups or small caregiver mm-hmm. education mm-hmm. classes, you know, small things, not big things. The big things that I live in that neighborhood myself. So the things that would concern me would be the evening events, the after-hours things, the things that are bringing the traffic into the neighborhood after dark, and who's coming into the neighborhood to the events, and that kind of thing.
Correct. Okay. Well, thank you. I just wanted to be clear about that. Commissioners, are there questions?
Madam Chair, getting back to your original question then, would you be comfortable, and I guess perhaps I'll ask you first, Ms. Poteet, a couple floating nights, you know, keeping these hours, but with adding a couple floating nights during the week proper, Monday through Friday, is that, I just want to understand what you would prefer so we can kind of make a decision.
I think that would be perfect. Yeah, just to give some flexibility in who we could offer the space to if they needed it. But not open it up 7 days a week, which in turn helps us. So keeps us, you know, from having to schedule and things like that.
Okay. All right. I think that's helpful. Right. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you. Yes, you may sit down. All right. Is there anyone else who would like to speak in favor of the application? Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition to this application? Yes, sir, if you'll come down. And when you reach the podium, sir, if you'll please state your name and address for the record.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Richard Strom. I'm a resident adjoining this property here. I've heard the plans which is proposed for the site, particularly the site which is currently paved over and so on. We've had recently an example of what can happen when someone comes in with a chainsaw and starts to develop in a neighborhood like this down on the end of Town Creek Road and Silver Bluff. So I just want to find out what the plans for parcel A and C are and why they would be included in any zoning change. Thank you.
You'll hold on one moment till we find... excuse me.
It should be on your screen, but it's also the fold-out in here.
Yes, that's where I was headed. That was how it was presented to us. Was there any...
this is what the applicant is proposing, or what the church is proposing to convey to the applicant. This is a planned district, so an applicant would need to come back if they were to make any significant changes to the site, such as new additions, new circulation, anything along those lines, would have to come back through the whole process of zoning, which is a hearing before the Planning Commission. And
as I understand the proposal, everything which is marked in red on this is going to be have its zoning changed. Is that correct?
Correct. Yeah. So that changes to the planned industrial, and so that whole site would be subject planned institutional. My apologies. Planned institutional. I keep saying that. But so that whole site would be subject to the full review process if any changes were to occur on parcels A or C.
Right. Could the current parcel, which is currently developed, be split off in terms of the zoning so that parcels A and C remain unchanged from their current zoning? If there is no intended use for them, there should be no change requested for that.
Well, parcel A contains the sanctuary and building C.
No, the parcel A here is a piece of vacant land behind the cemetery, which is currently wooded.
I think it extends up, doesn't it, Ryan? And parcel A include the...
does it not come up to...
doesn't it go all the way up to the town creek?
Correct. I think parcel C is your only...
Parcel C is the separate, but parcel A contains the buildings.
Correct.
Yeah.
Parcel A is the church,
too.
Yeah, parcel A contains the church building and the Sunday school building.
And the wooded area behind it.
Okay. And the gym. I think the gym's on NA.
Is this section from here all the way to this fence back here is currently wooded. Right. There's nothing built back here.
Correct. But the buildings are on A2.
Oh, okay.
See, well, it becomes...
the A is an L-shaped.
Parcel C then could remain residential. There's no reason to change that unless there is intention to use it for a purpose other than its current usage.
Isn't the norm to do the whole thing one?
It would be typically, yes. Because we would need separate legal descriptions,
right,
for the sites. I would point out that if parcel A were to remain residential, a individual could build a single family residence on there by right.
Parcel C?
If you were to divide parcel A into multiple parcels, parcel C would be different because it would... that's the other issue, is that you cannot landlock a property, a parcel, without access.
Say, what about egress and egress?
Where are you? Where is your? Are you on Springwood, or are you back on?
I'm on Gleanwood, and my property adjoins parcel C in the southwest corner of parcel C. Mm-hmm. And I must, tell the commission here that the problem that we see looks like a repeat of what was done recently down on the corner of Town Creek and Silver Bluff, where houses, the woods behind these very lovely homes was just leveled.
Well, that it is different in the sense that this is being changed to what they call planned institutional, mm-hmm. which is vastly different than the designation. I forget what the exact designation, Liz, is on the one. It's commercial, I think. Or
I think it's PC.
I think it's PC, mm-hmm. which is totally commercial. That's a commercial lot.
Mm-hmm.
It's a professional commercial lot.
Mm-hmm.
This is going to be what they call plans institutional, which is vastly different zoning category.
And
as the chainsaw doesn't respect the zoning laws.
Well, as Mr. Bland has said, if they wanted to make some changes, such as, you know, leveling that parcel, it would have to come back before us to request permission to do that.
I see.
If they chose, if their chainsaw knew no zoning, then they could be required to replant what they had done. And so there would be consequences for that renegade chainsaw. That's one of the nice things about the planned institutional is that we are approving it as it is, you know, whatever we end up agreeing on is the motion. That then will, you know, any other changes will have to be reapplied for.
Thank you.
I hope that helps you. Okay. All right. Yes, ma'am, would you like to be heard? Okay. Okay.
And I think.
Oh, I'm sorry. Would you mind?
My name is Karen Gutman, Gutmann. And personally, I'm not that concerned about what this couple wants to do with the property. I'm encouraged to know that they live in our neighborhood. I figure they're going to help take care of it for us. And it seems like a good business. What concerns me is if we change the zoning, what can the next person do? And if we change the zoning, then these owners or somebody else wants to do something else with the property, and they come and they ask, will they be able to cut down all the trees? We have all seen the same thing down the end of the block. That's probably what's in the back of all of our minds. And there's a lot of nice houses there that are now looking at an ugly drainage ditch in a parking lot. Their property values have no doubt gone down. And we don't want to see that happen to any of our homes, of course. In that area, it is zoned commercial, but it's also, there's a number of businesses there, whereas we are smack in the middle of a very residential, long-standing, established neighborhood of families. And we also don't want to see, I'm speaking for myself and my husband, we don't want to see kind of the slippery slope.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, Town Creek is a kind of busy road. We don't want to see it head in that direction. So can you tell me what are the differences between residential and planned institutional that they can request and might be approved?
That's an excellent question. I was getting his manual out, so we'll give you the exact verbatim. There are limited uses for the planned institutional, and remember, any changes that anybody down the road would want to do would have to come before us again, which would then afford y'all another opportunity to come back before us and express any concerns, which we do take very seriously.
Yeah, I would say planned institutional is probably one of the more restrictive zoning districts, and intentionally it was when it was written. It essentially allows for schools, daycares, churches, and like uses. The other thing that runs with a planned institutional is that not only does it come with the plan, it also comes with the use that's permitted that we're discussing now. So if there would be a significant change in use, it would also need to come back before the board.
Have to be rezoned, because those are the only limited uses for institutional.
Usually it's us expressing the concern that you're making when an applicant comes before us, and it's usually a general business where we're usually very concerned because someone
That's
wants to go
open.
In and fix a blighted, do something new on a blighted property, and they think it's a no-brainer. Why would anyone say no? And it's usually us saying, but someone can come behind you
right.
and do A, B, or C But it's usually general business where we're really concerned about.
That's the loosest one, yeah. I think we have. But anytime you see a zone that says, you know, planned anything, it's a lot more restrictive, and this is probably the most restrictive category that we have. So they could, you know, no. First of all, no one other than those types of businesses could ever apply, you know, to be in that as it would be currently zoned. If they wanted something different, they would have to apply for a total rezoning, and then we would certainly look at the factors of being in a neighborhood. We're very sensitive, and I think it's fair to say on behalf of all of us, we're very sensitive to any type of business that's located within a primarily residential area. For that very reason, it can be a slippery slope.
Okay, if it was to remain residential and someone purchased it, could they raise all the trees
and build a house?
Houses there. I mean, what I'm trying to figure out, what does this zoning give an owner that we're protected from?
Residential, they would actually have more ability to take trees down than they would under planned institutional.
Okay.
Because if it was, is that, I mean,
that's correct.
That's true.
Okay.
You know, so really, if you want to look at it this way, it is even more restrictive than a residential zoning would be.
As far as the trees go.
As far as the trees go.
One condition that we have discussed is that the applicant, being the Poteets here, would submit a landscape and tree preservation plan for the site that complies with the City of Aiken zoning ordinances. That would be part of the conditions that I think we would propose that they accept. And any removal of trees would be reviewed and confirmed by the city horticulturist and planning director.
So
institutional, you really have a lot more control over trees than you do if it's residential. This residential, they can come in there and clear cut it, build a house.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Hope that makes you feel a little bit better. All right, is there anyone else who would like to? Yes.
My name is Janelle Jansen. I live up the street from the church. I had just a couple of comments. I'm sure this is a fine business and you're fine people, but when I moved to Gem Lakes, I would have never dreamt that living in an established neighborhood, I would end up with a commercial business right down the street from me. It's not a community center. It's not a place for concerts. It's a commercial business right in the middle of a residential area. Part of the reason for zoning is to protect property owners. But by changing this and bringing a commercial business right into the middle of a neighborhood, you're not protecting the property of the people adjacent to it. You're going to generate income for the city because you're going to tax this place differently than you are a church. Oddly enough, the church that had to leave went to a daycare business that went out of business. We talked about the slippery slope. What happens if 5 years from now these folks decide, I don't want to be in this business anymore. I want to sell the property. Well, PI is very restrictive, as you said. Well, what if she can't find someone to sell a PI-zoned piece of property to, and somebody else comes and says, okay, I got this great idea, and they come back to you and to say, in order to sell this property for more money, just like the church is asking, they want more money for it, they need less restrictive zoning, I need you to change the zoning yet again. And it's not a slippery slope, it's falling off a cliff. Once you change the zoning for the first time, I have never seen a zoning request denied. I've seen neighborhoods become commercial areas time after time after time. I've lived in Aiken since 1982. I remember when Bilo was a neighborhood, when Darty Road was a neighborhood, when Silver Bluff was a neighborhood. I don't want Town Creek and my neighborhood to become like all of these other ones that through zoning have been allowed to degrade into nothing more than strip malls. You need to protect us property owners. That's part of your job, not necessarily to promote commercial business in a residential area. I have And I'm not saying it's not a needed business. It would be nice if that needed business were held, were put in an existing building, which there are many sitting vacant around this area, or put in an area that's not in the middle of a neighborhood. And one question I have about the trees and the landscape, I mean, we're all horrified at what happened down on the end of Town Creek Road. Y'all allowed for that to happen. You put no buffer between the neighborhood. Whoever changed the zoning, and I believe it's this zoning board, sanctioned that activity. But what are you going to do about stormwater runoff? When they sell this piece of property, they now have to comply with stormwater runoff laws. How are they going to deal with that property, which all slopes onto Springwood, and bring that back into their property with approved stormwater drainage? How is that going to be managed? Or am I wrong in thinking that they have to comply with the stormwater runoff laws?
Stormwater management is the laws kick in with a change in impervious surface. So if there were to be a plan where there'd be additional buildings, additional hardscape, things like that, then some of those on-site retention requirements would kick in.
So as long as they don't touch any of the asphalt, they don't have to change any of the stormwater retention?
The increase, yeah. So it would, yeah.
If it's working now, then any changes to that that would alter its ability to handle it as it's currently being handled would then fall under those requirements. Let me try to address a few of your comments, though. First of all, I think just to be very accurate, this commission, and I've been on it for quite a while, has in fact turned down a significant number of applications. Just because they come before us does not mean it's automatic. And whether someone feels that they need to get a buyer to come before us to ask for rezoning so they can make more money, I will tell you, is not a factor in our decision. We are not here to facilitate somebody selling their property. We are here to make sure that the proposed use is in compliance with not only the comprehensive plan for the entire community, but for the specific neighborhood. If it falls under the guidelines that have already been established, then we have to have these open meetings where folks like you can come forth and show cause why that won't work. But we do look at each one very firmly and strongly, and we are really trying to do the best that we can as volunteers. We are, it's on one of us that has a job.
Let me ask you, is commercial business part of the master plan for Gem Lakes?
You know, to say that this is a commercial business, that using that term does not fit our definitions of guidelines. There are certain types of business that certainly are allowed in neighborhoods. Planned institution is one of them. The businesses that fall under the category of planned institution are allowed in neighborhoods. That is not to say that when we think of a commercial, we're thinking of something very different. We're thinking of a car wash. We're thinking of, you know, any other type of, you know, a bylow or something. That would not be allowed. But the category planned institutional is allowed in a residential area.
Okay, I was just curious about that. All right, that's it. I just hope you guys, when you do this, would at least take into consideration what it's going to do to the property values adjacent and to really to change the character of our part of the neighborhood.
Let me ask you, what makes you feel, what are you basing your concern that your property values will be diminished with this care facility that is not a whole lot different than, or is it, than having a church or some other institution like that?
Well, the church was there Wednesday evening and Sunday, not
every day.
Every day, with a lot more traffic every day, and noise and lights, and you know, it's been very low key through both of the churches that have been there, and now with it is a business. Let me not say a commercial business. It's a daily for profit business, and for the people that live next door, they're now going to have cars back and forth every day for up to, I guess, from 6 o'clock in the morning till 10 o'clock at night. PI allows for 16 hours worth of business. Whether or not they choose to do that, I don't know. But they are not always going to own that property. Somebody else can come in behind them that further degrades that property as far as the neighbors are concerned. Town Creek is already becoming a busier road, and now you're going to add 100, 200, 300 more cars a day on that road and at the end of my road.
Well, let me just make sure that you're very clear, because we appreciate your concern. And yes, you know, one of our factors that we consider is that slippery slope factor. But it isn't going to be as simple as them selling their business 5 years down the road, as the example you cited, and it instantaneously becoming something else. If they sell that property as it is, it can only be used for other types of business that are allowed within the planned institutional. The checks and balances are that they would have to come before us to change that zoning. So, and they would be subject to all of our checks and balances. So while, yes, certainly it's an appropriate concern to have, it isn't something that will happen instantaneously if they sell the property.
Yeah, and it's as we all say, it's the slippery slope that we're concerned about. We've seen it over and over and over again, and we would really like it to not be on our street. So.
Understood. Thank
you. I'm going to react to, you made a comment. You cannot compare this piece of property to the property down at the corner of Town Creek and Silver Bluff. It's apples and oranges. That was a commercial piece of property.
After it was rezoned.
But it was never residential.
What was it before it was
rezoned? I don't recall.
I think it was GB before.
We can check, and you can call the planning department to verify it, but I believe it was general business, which is a very, very open zone. I mean, you can do, that allows just about anything. So it was not the same situation as we have here. Additionally, we do have buffer zones on that. We have a landscape ordinance on that, and the developer has met, and I think Ryan will confirm it, he has met the buffer zones on those property back that backs up there.
They cut down all the way up to people's fences.
Well,
they clear cut it all the way up to people's fences.
We had one lady come in here when it was being done, and when it was being discussed. We had one lady who lives back there off of, I'm not sure, Huron or somewhere over there. She came in, raised the issue, and the developer agreed to deed her an additional piece of property. He cut out, a little triangle piece of property and deeded it to her. She was the only person that came in, from that strip of houses. She came in, he deeded her a piece of property. But there is certainly a buffer zone back there.
What does that buffer look like? Because right now I can stand on Town Creek and look at someone on their patio.
You can see completely through.
Yes, there is not a tree standing from Town Creek Road to the fence and backyard of the people that back up to it.
I don't think they're completely through with it. Ryan, I don't think they're completely through back there with putting up the buffer zone and the stuff. He may have to come back in there and add additional buffer. You know, there's an area back in there that is also flood. They had to make a pretty large flood zone back in there because of water.
The other day.
Yeah, because of water issues back in there. So he had to use more of it than he wanted to use to do that. But that was the only person that came in on that,
I mean, that's fine. I'm not here to argue that, but we see what's done in the name of zoning, and it's just a concern. And we've all, I mean.
Well, that's exactly why I was raising the points earlier, and I'm glad people are here. I didn't know who would be here. You know, the sign's been out there, right. So I didn't know who would be here, and I didn't know what their concerns would be. And you're right in the sense of if and when these people, what we're trying to do, or what we would do if we rezone it to this PI, then that's the zoning. These people might own it for 10 years. They might own it for a year. They might own it for 5 years. We don't know. But whoever they sell it to is also going to be under the same restrictions of the PI zoning as they are. And it's a planned concept, so they're going to, any changes they would have to come back in to get approval to do. But I also am sensitive to the idea of this is the problem you can have when you start expanding the number of nights per week.
Correct.
And it's a it illustrates the point, I think. Your point is well taken on that with me.
There's a big difference between having a senior daycare from 8 o'clock till 5 o'clock than having the cars in and out.
And having multiple events, multiple nights of the week that last till 9 o'clock at night or later.
That's not
that's different.
What you do in the middle of a neighborhood.
I agree with you.
So we'd appreciate your consideration in that.
Thank you very much. This has been very valuable, and we do appreciate everyone's position. Sir.
Point out our house before I come up.
All right.
We're on Glenwood. Right between Mr. Goodman's house and Mr. Bigger Strong's house, backing up to this piece of property. My name is Larry Henson, 1014 Glenwood Drive. I've listened to the conversation. As living between the Stroms and the Goodmans, my concerns are basically, I just echo what they have expressed to you. We looked at the property when we moved in. Everything was zoned for our residential. That was the understanding when we bought the property. And so we made that assumption when we bought it. My concerns would be that not what's coming in now necessarily, but the sale, or if it's something down the road, something that destroys the nature of that area we were in, the possibility of future development that would back into, particularly the property I think referred to as parcel C that comes back around lots of our houses. Mm-hmm. And I would ask you to take that in consideration, and I appreciate your understanding. Okay.
Thank you. Any questions for Ms. Jensen? Thank you, sir. Did I see another hand? Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Thomas Gutman, Karen's husband. She pointed out where our property is, 1020 Glenwood Drive. There was a fair amount of discussion with regards to the nights per week matter. And I guess in the give and take of that, I was somewhere between, or maybe it's two nights and maybe it's four nights. I wasn't exactly clear. It went back and forth a little bit. That's not where I'm focusing on, not the count specific, but rather what is the means of enforcing that? I'm assuming that there's not someone who's going to be on the property every night watching, you know, how many nights is it being used per week? Wouldn't expect that, certainly. So I'm thinking it would likely be the case of the neighbors who were monitoring things and maybe seeing that, gee whiz, it seems like I'm seeing a lot more activity and it's going on to a certain time of night.
Neighbor complaint is probably the number one that initiates enforcement.
So, and if I can pull that string a little bit, so is it the Aiken County Police that get the call, or what mechanism is available to the home affected homeowners in the event? I'm not saying this has anything to do with the proposed property owners. I'm just saying it gets back to the concept we had. If we change it now, 5 years, where are we going to be? Who knows? That kind of a thing. What is the mechanism that would be followed for the property owners in the event of seeing something beyond what was approved?
So if it's there 7 nights a week.
Pardon?
If it's there 7 nights a week, if there are lots of events, you're saying, and you have concerns and complaints.
Well, anything beyond the number of days that are agreed to.
Right, whatever it is. If it's in excess, okay, then, Ryan, they would notify.
Right, so it comes through planning and zoning. So planning has a zoning official. and the zoning official has called pseudo police power, so we can levy fines against zoning violations, things of that sort. So there are enforcement mechanisms similar to giving somebody a ticket, those sorts of things, and even going to court to get things stopped. So, but because it would be tied to the zoning, because these particular constraints would be tied to the zoning, but it would be the zoning official that would fall under.
Okay. And for that, you would need evidence.
Correct. Right?
And so would that be the police report again? Who do I call? If as an affected property owner, and over the past 3 months, I'm seeing, wait a minute, there's a whole lot of things going on. Who do I call?
I think if you just start tracking it, and you can say on this day, you know, there were a large number of cars from this time to this time, report it to planning, and then they, you know, would begin looking at investigating that. Certainly, I think the first thing would be to call and say, yes, are you doing this?
Okay, so if I were to see that as the scenario I described, and provided you with what I'll call my evidence, you know, here's my record.
That would start
like day one of your office saying, okay, we're going to be
correct
monitoring.
Right.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you.
An actual noise complaint would go to the police on any given night. I'm a rock musician, so I know all about that. Trust me. So I just wanted to make sure noise complaint versus an ordinance violation.
All right.
Just,
yeah. Great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Is there anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
Marianne Hinson. We're in the center house on Greenwood.
Well, I must say, it is delightful to see so many husbands and wives on the same page.
My concern is perhaps these groups that we're talking about coming in to use the sanctuary area, perhaps Alzheimer's conference group, what kind of numbers of people in excess of what are expected for the daycare would be anticipated to use that facility?
Well, I don't know what that, I know that the capacity of the sanctuary is about 150. But let's ask Ms. Poteet to come forward and give us an exact answer for you, hopefully.
I've been to a number of Alzheimer's conferences, and they've never had one in Aiken, so it would be a blessing, number one, to have one in Aiken so people don't have to travel mm-hmm. to Columbia. There's a lot of people in need of that type of thing in our community. But they're not very heavily attended. Maybe about 50 people. Mm-hmm. So you're not looking at a lot of people. And we are limited. That's one reason we don't want to take the pews out at the sanctuary, because it does limit our capacity. Mm-hmm. It limits what we can do. And so we're not looking for things to do there. We're looking for what we're allowed to let people do. Mm-hmm. The sanctuary is a bonus. Our business, we needed the gym property. Mm-hmm. But we don't need all the other property. We don't need the wooded land. We don't need any of that. But in order to get that one piece of property, we have to buy the whole shebang. And so what we're trying to do is find a good purpose for all of the pieces of the property. We have absolutely no intentions of making any kind of changes to landscaping, taking any kind of trees down. The only changes that we propose to any of the structures are for safety purposes and on cosmetic, so the aesthetics mm-hmm. of the neighborhood, and on the inside, safety and cosmetics, and, you know, bringing them up to where, you know, our seniors can have a nice day.
Certainly.
So this church thing has just been kind of a big question mark for my husband and I, because, like I said, we don't need the church. I would love to have a church that needed the church, but we don't have that right now. So we're just trying to find a proper use for this beautiful building that would benefit the community, that it's not going to sit vacant and dilapidate. If we don't use it in some way, occasionally, it's going to fall apart. And we don't want to have to repair a bunch of stuff that we really don't have a lot of use for anyway. So we would like to extend the use of the church to the community, just kind of as a thank you for letting us be in the community. Mm-hmm. So we're really not trying to cause controversy. We're just trying to find a good use for this icing on this cake that we're trying to do for this business.
Our concern of looking at
Thank you, Kim.
It's got 50 parking spaces. Let's say you have the Alzheimer's conference, then you've already got, if it's you want to use it during the day because that's more advantageous for that group, then your parking that's already there is going to be additional parking for those groups.
Well,
the same thing with band concert. You get parents coming in, you're going to have a lot more than probably 50 spaces. So spillover of parking into the neighborhood is of some concern.
We don't anticipate that. We behind the gym is the big asphalt.
Mm-hmm.
There's parking there for overflow. We don't anticipate events, you know, rock concerts. Kent is not coming to do a rock concert where there's going to be a lot of traffic and overflow parking onto Town Creek or Springwood. Mm-hmm. There's plenty of parking. Our seniors are normally not even going to drive. They're going to be dropped off. So they're not using a lot of parking. So if there was an event during the day, that parking should be adequate. And if not, in the back of that gym building. Mm-hmm. So there's way more parking than we need. I have now two seniors who drive and park at our place now. Mm-hmm. So they're normally being dropped off for the day and picked up later.
Yep.
So that's really not an issue.
Okay, thank you. Any other?
I'll just say, sure. Both my parents passed away with Alzheimer's, so that it's a wonderful, I wish there had been something, my parents lived several hours away, something like that would have been lovely. It's just some of the other activities that might be there, again, band concerts, I'm assuming, or student bands.
Student, like the homeschool band. Or...
Yeah, but that's a lot of parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles. Just have worked in an elementary school. You give something that the kids are doing and everybody in the family shows up. So that's it is a lot of parking potentially. So that was my concern.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. We appreciate that. Thank you, Karen.
Madam Chair, if I may, I just want to make a clarification along those lines too. When staff did the assessment of parking, normally a religious institution is calculated at one person per five or parking space per five. We analyze this per the more stringent standard of 1.3 for other general assemblies. So we try to err on the conservative side on that.
Good. Okay. And it still came up adequate.
It still came up adequate.
One thing, Liz, I want to make this point, and everybody may know this point. Of course, this board understands this. This is the Planning Commission. We are a referring body. We are not the final arbiter of this. We will make a recommendation, and then that recommendation will go to City Council. If you don't like our recommendation, stay on top of it, go to City Council, express the same reservations that you have expressed here tonight. And the City Council will make the final decision, just like they made on the piece up on the corner.
Thank you.
Mr. Planning Director, if I may, you had originally talked that you had put together all the possible conditions so that the impacts would be no more intense than the church was, right? I just wanted to...
Correct. Maximum use, that was the idea. The maximum use, that it would be no more intense than the church. But again, kind of taking into account the general uses that are available through the planned institutional district,
right,
which again are very limited. Basically, it's church and school uses with the addition of daycares, which are just seem to be fairly on the low impact side is, you know, something that has a more residential character is the intent of that zoning district.
All right, is there anyone else who would like to be heard on this? Yes, sir.
My name is John Anderson. I am not an adjacent property owner. I live on Huckleberry Drive at 1810. I moved there in 1982. I moved from Charleston County, which was a county with zoning, and I moved to Aiken County, and I looked in Aiken City and Aiken County at property, and had a very good realtor who I asked questions about zoning and what should I do as a property purchaser with zoning. And this realtor advised me very wisely. I looked at a piece of property that is now the Red Cross on Pine Log Road. I asked who owned the property across the street, which was wooded, similar to the property that Tiffany and company, the doctor, now has on Town Creek Road. And I was told that's owned by a developer, very possibly will be developed. It's county. I stopped looking at property on Silver Bluff and Pine Log Roads for that reason.
That was
Town Creek
wise.
Church was there when I moved there and was there for a number of years, a wonderful church. When Town Creek Church left there, a Reformed Presbyterian church used that property for several years. After that, another church, I cannot remember the name, used that property for a church. And it was very successfully used by those folks. And it did not change the complexion of the community because it was church. Churches meet on Sunday morning, maybe Sunday night, Wednesday evening. Large on Sunday morning, smaller on Sunday night, smaller on Wednesday. That's the complexion of a church. I do not question at all the motives of these folks. I think what they do is wonderful. I'm not questioning the senior center, and I don't want to question what they're doing at all. But Town Creek Church owns the property, and I realize they need to do something with it. The dilemma is, for residents there, the change in the property, not when they own it, but when you change this designation, I do not believe there's any way that you can do it and make it like a church. There's nothing that keeps the institutional owner from renting that to a party, a raucous party. There's nothing that I know of, and you can correct me, that keeps them from doing that. Not that they would do it. I'm not questioning that. But if they sell the property in a year or two, that's a large investment. I'm sure it is. I have no idea what they're going to pay for it. But if they sell that property, there's nothing in there that's going to prevent them from renting it to a rock band. No offense. I love rock and roll. I love all kinds of music. But my point is, it changes the community. Real estate developers have continued to develop the area around my home. Jim Lakes developed down to the lakes on my side, on the Huckleberry Farm side, it's called in the plats. A developer developed a street right next to this, I'm going to call it the Tiffany property. I realize there's some developer, and Dr. Tiffany, wonderful doctor, has his new office there with now 40, 50 cars there, just at that one building. I counted them the other day. Town Creek Road is now, in 2017, a very busy road. It is a shortcut from North Augusta, to Silver Bluff Road. Heavily traveled. It is a heavily traveled road. It is no longer a residential street. With the Tiffany property and that development, they keep saying they're going to put, I have to change my traffic pattern. My direction for leaving my community and coming downtown is now different because of that. Allowing this change to happen changes the complexion of that property. And I believe it changes my neighborhood. I've been there since 1982. I'd like to stay for another 9 or 10 years. I am not against what they're doing. I think if it were limited to this couple doing what they want to do, but once you make that zoning change, it's done. It is done. Now, whether that property that is now the Tiffany doctor's office, another doctor's office, now townhomes, a large retention pond that backs up to those properties. I looked at property on one of those streets. I am so happy I didn't buy that house because I would be selling. I'm sorry for the folks that live right near the church because the uncertainty of what they're doing is there. For someone who has invested significant resources, the largest investment generally a couple makes is in a home. And I'm just concerned, if you make a change, if you recommend this to the city council, then it changes. It's
Sir,
no longer a church.
You do understand that the proposed change to institutional is far more stringent than what it currently is.
It
and
is.
It is not at all like what you're comparing it to.
But it is owned by a church. Yes, ma'am.
All right, well, you know, you just understand that we're proposing a lot more
yes.
limitations than the residential.
I fully recognize that.
And it's
that.
Not the same as the commercial where Dr. Yes. Tiffany's office is.
To me, a much worse change.
Well.
I don't mind saying that, but it is owned
But I mean,
by,
we're not anywhere near that.
I understand that, but it is owned by a church. I trust Town Creek Church. It's not that I don't trust these folks, but once that zoning change is made, it's done. And it changes it from a church. That is undeniable. It may be less than what it is today, but my point is it changes it from what it is from a church. I have seen the changes done by not just the city, the county for lack of zoning, and the city in order to take in property, takes county property, zones it in the city, allows things to happen. I understand how that all works. If you change it, it's no longer a church. Thank you.
Well, it probably won't be a church again if the church is selling it.
I understand that.
You know.
I understand that. I would hope
we could only apply for what they're...
I would hope that another church would buy it, and I know that's a long shot. Two churches have used it since then, and I recognize it is deteriorating. I walk through there on my walks.
Thank you for your comments. Is there anyone else who would like to be heard on this application? Please, yes.
Mark Petit, 113 Hartwell Drive. I just want to make a comment, and please correct me if I'm wrong. Based on what I've heard, I think everybody's, one, trying to judge this based on something that happened on the other side of the road, which is unfair. Planned institutional, I think you've tried to explain it, but I think it needs to be clear that we put in the application, we put in the plan, you approve it. If we were to ever sell this property, someone else would have to have their plan approved before anything could be done with it. Our plan, if it gets approved, we've asked to cut down 4 dead trees, not a forest. We've asked to improve the visual aspects of the exterior, not add any buildings, not add any parking space, no pavement. What we're trying to do is, and going back to the church, it is a church. It's not going to be a church because Town Creek is selling the property. Had I not accidentally found that out, the plan was to sell it to a real estate developer to level the property. I think R15 could have up to 16 houses on that property. Is that correct?
I think so.
I would much rather 3 buildings be there if I live there. So that's my take on if I live behind that. We're not looking to change the look of it. We're looking to update it and keep the buildings as they are. And I just want the neighbors to know that. An email was sent out. I hope everybody in the neighborhood got it with phone numbers to contact if they have any direct questions, if they want to look at the business as it is now to see what would be there. So it's not a noise-making business. It's 90-year-olds for there for the day. It doesn't run into the night hours. If anything does, if there's a meeting there, it's not a rock meeting. If it's a concert with homeschool kids, you're limited to who can be there. we have pews in the church. We're not taking those out because it triggers a whole different aspect that we're not going to deal with. And if we did, we would have to come back to you guys.
That's correct.
So that's not something that I want the neighborhood to be worried about, that there's going to be 400 people out there, you know, at one of your concerts. It's going to be very limited to how many people can be there, no matter what's done there, in the sanctuary, as well as who can attend the adult daycare. So I just wanted to say that piece in case it helps anything, but anybody in the neighborhood is free to contact, well, me or mainly Karen. She would be the one to answer more of how the business runs and what's done with it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to be heard on this application? All right, then it will be back to the commission. And commissioners, since we have a tremendous amount of information to process and consider, may I suggest that someone make a motion to suspend the rules so that we can have an open discussion before we get a motion?
So moved. Second.
All in favor? All right, so we've been presented with an awful lot of information that I feel is very important for us to consider. It seems to me that, and I want to have a discussion about this, that the primary use of the property under this proposal is not at all in question. It is the secondary use of the sanctuary that seems to be presenting the most concerns. Have you all heard that the same way? All right, well, let's have a conversation about what we could do to compromise and make a motion that might resolve some of these issues. What are some of y'all's thoughts?
Well, I think first and foremost, under any circumstances, that I don't think we'd approve anything, getting back to what I was talking about with the planning director, anything that was quote-unquote more intense than what the church use was in that secondary use, without a doubt. So I would use that as a starting point. If people are used to some cars coming going on Wednesday night and that was all that they saw for all those years during the weekdays, I'm not prepared to approve anything more intense or more invasive than that.
Charles, your thoughts?
I concur with Kent.
Okay.
I think a good point to this is that typically on a church given aspect, you have a Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday evening service. And I think a lot of the churches that we've seen recently, they're more of a 9-to-5 for-profit business internally. So my recommendation on that aspect would be no more than 3 days, less than 50% of a 7-day week, Sunday to Monday.
Yeah, I concur. I came in here with an attitude that was
you always have an attitude.
Was pretty well. I was going to justify my attitude, just explain my attitude. It was pretty positive. My initial reaction to this was pretty positive because I know when I look at this kind of situation, I definitely feel for the homeowners there. It's uncertainty. There's uncertainty here, and nobody likes that. But the what's going to happen is eventually Town Creek is going to sell this property. They are not going to keep it forever. And if it doesn't go planned institutional, it is zoned residential now, they are probably going to sell it to a developer who is going to come in there and he's going to put houses like the houses, which y'all know where I'm talking about, running up Plantation Drive there, where you got the smaller lots and the nice houses, but they're smaller lots. That's probably what a developer would do. Now, that's one alternative. The other alternative is this, something like this, a planned institutional use, and restricting the type of activities the event activities and the nights and upon which they can be held and the time frame upon which they would be held. And now, but John Anderson is right. This does change the complexion in the fact that it's not a church anymore. I'm with him on that. It does change that. But alternatively, I think it is possible to do it under planned institutional with a concept plan, which is pretty restrictive, and restricting the number of nights and the hours to make it so that it would be a minimum change and have a minimum effect on the people living right there.
Well, it seems to me, you know, I certainly understand and agree with a lot of the comments that have been made. I certainly think that the complexion of the property will change. It's not a church. I do agree with your point that the church will probably end up selling to someone. And I think that to me, it seems there's a lot less risk with going to planned institutional than there is leaving it as it is currently zoned in terms of residential and what could happen with that property. So while it will look different in terms of its usage, it won't be a church, I think the protections that would be in place would be so much more restrictive that there's less risk in a change to a planned institutional than leaving it. Because if the church cannot sell to someone who's going to use it for a function like this, they will sell it to a developer who will build a lot more houses on that. And I will feel confident there's probably going to be some clear cutting. There's that renegade chainsaw again. So, I think that we need to keep that in mind in terms of how we can protect the integrity of that property as long as possible. I think the issue really is the alternative use. And I think it's probably legitimate to restrict that since that is only a secondary use and not the primary use. Anything else that you all want to say or think we need to consider?
Mr. Planning Director, if I may, could you just reiterate one last time about if this zoning change is made and they turn around, they bought it on Monday and sold it on Tuesday, the people who bought it on Tuesday, what would they be subject to with regards to us and City Council?
So they would be subject to the use being approved tonight and the conditions being approved tonight until that changes by ordinance. So in the case of a change to a planned district, the use and the site plan that you see is the zoning at that point for that particular property from a point forward until somebody comes through and change and requests a change, and it goes all the way back through the consideration process.
Thank you, and I was kind of getting to Madam Chair's checks and balances discussion from before.
Right, I think that's far more restrictive than if it was left at residential. All right, if there are no other comments or points to be made.
Madam Chair, one more comment, I guess. Within our packet, I mean, this is already considered institutional zone in the comprehensive plan. So, I mean, that is another factor here.
Yes.
That is it is zoned RS-15, but it is considered an institutional use of the comprehensive plan, which is
right,
what we kind
of
go
there.
By.
Mm-hmm. That's right. So it is not out of keeping with
current concepts.
That's right, with the concept plan. All right. If there are no other comments, then I'll entertain a motion to reinstate the rules.
So moved. Second.
All in favor? All right, now we're ready for a motion. Would someone like to make a motion? This is the part where one of you speaks.
I'm just
okay.
Madam Chair, if I may, I move with regard to application 17-0003 rezoning and 17-22003 concept plan. That we approve this in the affirmative to City Council with all of the conditions stated, 1 through 7, and I'd like to make a modification to the first one, if I may. Mm-hmm. That being, it says that any event activities held in the former church sanctuary, which is, I think, was kind of the crux of the conversation, should be held during the weekends and only between the hours of 8 and 9 p.m. So I'd like to stick to those hours. Nothing, and I would just like to add one floating weekday and no more, just like the church. Subject to the same hours.
Okay. Is there a second to the motion?
A second.
All right, any discussion? All right, all in favor? Okay. All right, now our process going forward, we are a recommending body, so now this application will be recommended for approval to City Council. So if you want to attend the City Council meeting and express your views, that would certainly be appropriate. Once City Council has made its ruling, then the ordinance will go into effect. All right. So now let's look at items D and E. This is application 17-60002. And for rezoning and application 17-22002, which for concept plan, Max LB Peachtree Housing Communities is the applicant. Is there someone who would like to speak on behalf of that application since our ranks have really dwindled now?
Good evening, Madam Commissioner, Commission. My name is Max Elby with Peachtree Housing. My address is 1831 Village Crossing Drive, Charleston, South Carolina, 29492. We currently own Longleaf Senior Village Phase 1, which is a 50-unit, 55 and older senior community located on the southwest, directly adjacent to the subject property we're talking about getting rezoned. We've had great demand for that product in that location. We leased the first phase up in a month, so we would like to do a second and possibly third phase, totaling the 79 units, I believe. Total of 79 units. The second phase will be 49 units of an additional in 1 3-story building with an elevator. And then an additional 20 units in four fiveplex cottages. We're going to restrict this to residents 55 and older. No children will live there. And I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have. I would like to speak to a couple of the proposed or possible conditions, if I could, at this point.
Certainly.
Okay. The possible condition number 1 on page 6 talks about the turnaround to be added. We're fine with that. Possible condition number 2 talks about a 35-foot. Currently, we can only build to 35 feet. We'd like to be able to build to 40 feet. We think the building would be more attractive. And then on conditions 3, 4, and 5, we would just ask for 90 days to be changed to 180 days. We are applying for our financing on this, and it's just going to take us. I would hate to be restricted to those 90 days. Just asking for a little more time.
That change from 35 to 40 feet will allow for 9-foot ceilings then. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right, commissioners, what questions do you have for Mr. Elby?
I just want to make sure I understand. On number 5, you want 180 days on that as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
On 3, 4, and 5.
3, 4, and 5.
That isn't a problem if we change it, is it? Or is there some guideline about that?
Okay.
That's just never come up.
Yeah, I think the concern is just a timely manner, so.
Okay. Well, getting financing
right.
Makes it timely, right?
Right.
All right. Any questions? This is what's nice when you're after all the questions we have had. All right. Anybody else want to speak to this? All right, then I will make it back to the commission for a motion.
Madam Chairman, with regard to application 17-6002 and 17-22002, I would move that we approve those with the conditions 1 through 5, changing 3, 4, and 5 to 180 days, and condition 2, changing that to 40 feet.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
You've been on a roll tonight with that. All right. Any discussion? Okay, then I'll call for the vote. All in favor? Okay, that's about as good as it gets. So this will now go with our recommendation to City Council.
John, right? Joe? What's his name, Joe?